Mishra and Anna Sintisaro. Can I ask them to come to the stage, please? So the floor is yours. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. And good morning to all, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this beautiful morning. I am Arvinda.
And myself, Anna.
Anna is going to handle this first part of the session. I'll come back later. So over to you, Anna.
Thank you. Welcome again to the first plenary session of today on setting the priorities, science of change and resilience, and policy preparedness for action. I would also like to introduce our rapporteurs of today, Soumya Deep and Nishikant from ISIMOD, sitting here on the side. And next, it's my pleasure already to introduce the chair of this session, Dr. Asun Lera St. Clair, independent member of ISIMOD Board of Governors, senior principal scientist of Climate Change Technology and Research Group, DNV-GL, from Norway. May I invite you to the stage, Dr. Asun? Our other distinguished speakers today are Professor Yanfeng Wang, Vice President of the University of Chinese Academy of Sciences, and also an independent member of ISIMOD Board of Governors. Dr. Yusuf Zafar, Chairman of the Pakistan Agriculture Research Council. Professor Asit K. Biswas, winner of the Stockholm Water Prize, also distinguished visiting professor at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, National University of Singapore. And Dr. Atiq Rahman, Executive Director of Bangladesh Center for Advanced Studies. And Dr. René van Bergel, Representative of Regional Office UNIDO, the United States Industrial Development Organization in India. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, speakers. Now I'd like to hand over the conduct of the session to our Chair, Dr. Asun, please.
Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be the chair of this first session today. And I would like to actually set the tone for the rest of the 3 days to make sure that we have a conversation among our wonderful panelists, but a conversation with all of you. So I would like to invite the audience to pay attention to the framing questions for the panelists, because I will open the floor for questions and we would like to have your interventions. But democracy and conversations come with rules, so I'm going to have to ask you to have maximum one question only and 30 seconds to formulate your question when I open the floor, so we can get as many as possible. So that will be important, and I will be very bossy regarding these rules. So what are we debating today with our wonderful panelists? We are debating 4 critical challenges related to setting the priorities for resilience in the HKH. The first is the challenges related to science. The second are the challenges related to knowledge uptake, the science policy society interface. The third is about resources, finances, and capabilities to scale up solutions. And the fourth is related to the challenges for regional cooperation, the importance of regional cooperation, and the cost of non-cooperation, so important in this region, but also in the world. So just to set up these themes, I want to sort of bring to the audience some information many of you may know, but I think is absolutely remarkable, and it follows from some of the comments made by the general by Sir Parthadas Gupta in relation to integrated research and the importance of speaking to one another. The large global science organizations, ICSU and ISSC, the International Council for Science and the International Social Science Council, just merged a few weeks ago to create one single council, the International Council for Science. And what is the motivation behind this? And those councils are the ones who collect all the associations of all the disciplines of the world. Fantastic. The challenge that they were presented with and that they want to address are precisely the challenges that we are discussing in this conference. It's the need for integrated research across the sciences in order to address global challenges. It's the need to co-create knowledge with society, with policymakers, to co-design and co-produce that knowledge, not to sit in our ivory towers and then communicate that knowledge. It doesn't work. We have decades of expertise that this doesn't work. And it's also co-sharing, co-sharing the goals and co-sharing the ideas and the visions for those solutions that are going to lead to increased well-being. So with these introductory remarks, I'm going to give the floor to our panelists in order. We're going to speak sitting here. You will have 5, maximum 7 minutes. We have our facilitators with very strong voices, more than mine, to also show us cards. First, Professor Chanfeng Wang, to give us some very concrete and very detailed ideas. So let's try to bring the discussion to concrete issues. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I'm glad to be a part of the conference and be the panelist of this session. But I may have some very specific comments and also point on the resilience. It is not a new concept. It is not only belongs to HKH region. It's a concept is there a long time and the numerous definition in ecology, in social science, and the other sciences. But its original meaning is about the ability of a system to the degree and speed of a system to bounce back to maybe the original, maybe equilibrium state. So that's the original concept. But later on, this concept was accepted by other sciences, which take the place of recovery and resistance. So that means resilience is a combination of recovery and resistance of a system. But nowadays, when we talk about the hazards, earthquakes, and also some other like floods, we mainly focus on the recovery. We seldom talk about the resistance. So from the based on the research of science, especially for me, I'm a scientist in ecology, so I focus more on the natural ecosystem. Sometimes social societies, the community was are involved in the system. But generally based on the natural ecosystem research results, you think the resilience is a combination not only the recovery and the resistance, but also from other contexts is the structure and the function. We nowadays the resilient, or these days we talked more about the structure and the recovery. We seldom mention the function and the resistance. So I would like to mention that when we talk about the resilience, we would like to combine these two parts, the resistance and the recovery. the structure and the function, and more important, the solution may be from the inside, depends more on inside reorganization than from outside. So that's my point. It's the concept and also the solution be from internal reorganization instead of external organization. That's my second point. And the third one, I think from the experience in China, recovery and the capacity building of resistant of a system, we prefer to have the training or the education from the disaster itself. Knowledge is important, but the knowledge transferring and also the lessons from learn from the nature, learn from the disaster itself may be more helpful for the local community. We have some very important experience we prefer to share with other community in remote area. In this year after the earthquake, the floods, and other mountain hazards. So I, the first 5 minutes, I just try to figure out the concept of resilience and the possible solution, maybe from the internal reorganization, and also we need to learn more from the nature instead of only the knowledge. That's is the 3 points. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this very interesting theoretical perspective on resilience. And we will expand later on examples of some of these concepts in terms of resistance and function. Thank you. Please, Mr. Dr. Jusuf-Tahar, floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and very good morning. Yesterday morning, we discussed something regarding specific to Pakistan. I will develop more on these issues. First of all, as probably most of you are aware, that in the greenhouse gas emission, Pakistan rating is about 137. We are placed at 137 number. But in vulnerability to climate change, we are at the top 10, the 7th position of Pakistan. So, which means that there is a global impact, whether you are not contributing to the climate change, but on the receiving end, you cannot avoid it. So,
one is Singapore, but Singapore is a very different country. I don't know if you, ladies and gentlemen, know, Singapore is the only country in the world where its MPs are headhunted like a private sector organization. And that is why the ministers are absolutely brilliant. And they go by evidence. They go by good knowledge. I go to India. I go to Bangladesh. I come to Nepal. I don't see the, if I go in a year's time, I don't see the same minister. Very rarely I see the same secretary. Very rarely I see the same joint secretary. They're gone. From 1 year to another, they're gone. China has more evidence-based policy formulation than any of these countries. Because if I look at in China, last 20 years, there have been two water ministers, and the second minister is still on, still continuing. In contrast, in India, there have been 12 water ministers the last 20 years, and one of them stayed for all of one day. Right now, there is no minister, and another for another 3.5 years, there's a different minister looking at water per se as a second portfolio of secondary interest. So this is the issue. How do you get the politicians interested in water or resilience or whatever it is? You have to talk their language. If you cannot talk their language, I'm afraid that all this talk about the evidence-based knowledge is not going to help us very much. And finally, more things will come up in the discussion. All I want to say is, we know a lot, we know how to do things, but how to get in the political basis, political spectrum, is a very difficult process. We scientists have to leave our scientific ivory tower and make sure that ivory tower is not the only place of resistance. If we stay in the ivory tower, I'm afraid we'll not be able to reach the politicians, our politicians. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Good morning to all of you. Great pleasure to be here. It's a personal privilege and pleasure to be in this new building. So congratulations to ISIMOD. Today, just to echo Sir Partha's first sentence, we are in the best of times and worst of times. Despite all the problems, war, discontinuity, Brexit and indecision in US and many other systems, we have got three major global convergence that has taken place in 2015, leading us, the world, to a complete different and hopefully newer space of thinking and hopefully better integration. These are in 2015, as Eklavya already mentioned, the world has agreed to the Sustainable Development Goals, 17 of them. The first of them being poverty eradication. I have been involved in poverty-related activities for 40 years. Up to 10 years ago, we did not dare use the word eradication. This is the poverty alleviation. Eradication is a tough word. Hope we can make it, and we will. So a tremendous integrated 17 goals, which gives us an opportunity to work further. The Sendai framework, which was about disaster risk reduction, one of the greatest contributions to poverty is disaster, particularly of the poor. And these are natural disaster, climate-induced disaster, and many other poverty-induced disaster. The third was the Paris Agreement, however imperfect, of where all the countries of the world have agreed to work together for climate convergence and climate action. This is also under SDG 30 of the SDGs. And only in COP23 in Bonn, all the countries of the world, the two countries that were left behind or that wasn't signing was Syria, which is in war, and the United States of America, which has at the presidential level has withdrawn. The good news is that there has been presence of large number of American companies, private, whole of private sector, who came to the conference and said, we will do everything that America promised despite what the White House was saying. So did the large number of states and mayors of the cities. So climate change is moving on in reasonably good direction, a bit slow though. All those major three convergence gives us an opportunity to move together further. And in this region, this is the region of tremendous progress and highest amount of poverty. So we must do significant amount of work in this region. And science technology must give us the way to move forward. And that moving forward must have a human face. And the way to do it is to integrate the type of knowledge and institutions that we have, which will help us to go further and go together. ASEAN has been working reasonably well. SAARC has not been working that well in South Asia. But regional cooperation is the way forward, where countries, research organizations, institutions that already are cooperating with each other, those networks, they must be strengthened to enhance regional cooperation for all. And that needs focused work on issues of water, climate change, energy, food security, the key issues, and food security must move on to nutritional security now, because food security is, in the simplest term, food on the plate. Nutritional security is the food that goes into the human body, gets really utilized by the human being. So that we have to look into a bit deeper. The critical issue that remains is an issue of institutionalization, cooperation within this region, and good governance of both institutions, networks, and the system of science, technology, knowledge base that we have. Now, we have two very big knowledge systems. One is the scientific knowledge system, which has gone through the Cartesian test of time, pursuit, asking the question, trying to answer the question, publish them in the international peer-reviewed literature, and agree that this has proved the test of time or test of science. There is another set of knowledge which is in the domain of the non-literate or in the people's domain, which is probably far larger in delivery systems than whole of scientific knowledge put together. Often we tend to ignore them. Now, communities across the world right now is feeding the world are the farmers and the fishers. Many of them are non-literate. They have a knowledge system which challenges their own experiential understanding of systems, and they take it forward further. We as scientists must try and understand that knowledge system and integrate our research into the way so that the people's welfare is in the highest priority in our work that the scientists do across the world. As rightly indicated by Professor Sid Biswas, that policy is not just policy formulation, is not a science, it's an art. And that art form must be better understood so that information can go in there and this information can come through the communities and people. The politicians understand that through their vote banks and vote systems, electoral systems, but often that hides the realities of minorities, of regions, particularly stressed ecosystems, which are really the critical area. One of the critical areas that has really has to be considered are the stressed ecological system, where poverty and degradation and disaster combine. So we must focus on those areas. So focusing on governance, institution building, better networking, servicing the communities would be one of the best relevance to the work we are doing here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And I think we should discuss later the actual feasibility of these very ambitious goals. Please, our last speaker, René Fumberto, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. By means of introduction, maybe UNIDO is the United Nations Industrial Development Organization. We are part of the UN system, the specialized organization that is then supporting industrialization in developing countries with the aim of globalization of trade for eradication of poverty and environmental sustainability. We work on the SDGs, which is, of course, globally agreed, ambitious goals for sustainability by 2030. We focus on SDG 9, which is industry, infrastructure, and innovation. But also, of course, the SDGs are all interlinked. I often say it's basically 17 sides of the same dice. So as soon as we start move, we will also move on the other ones. Within the energy domain, UNIDO supports, operates a global network of regional sustainable energy centers that bring countries together to develop and advance and scale up techniques and policies for energy efficiency and improved application of renewable energy technologies. Just over the past 2 days, Friday, Saturday, we had a meeting here together with ECMOD and funded by the Austrian Development Agency to explore the potential for renewable energy and energy efficiency in the center for the HKH region. I think that such center, if it works in close cooperation with other initiatives and the private sector, could really become a catalyst for finding mountain-based solutions for energy. And in that sense, we really look forward to trying to get this center operational here at ECMOD in 2018. Then maybe on the theme of resilience, and I think indeed resilience means many different things to different people, and that's also part of the solution. But I think that we talk about resilience as a binary issue. This is resilience, this is not resilient, and that's probably not right. So we talk about a gradual scale where communities can increase their ability to deal and the capacity to deal with the impacts and suffering from shocks. So in my view, resilience really involves and basically evolves the functions. It functions on the understanding, planning, and execution. Understanding concerns and the ability to assess what challenges are there, what are the developments, and also probably detect what changes are happening. Then, of course, the planning deals with identifying opportunities, not only to respond to and recover from shocks or disasters, but also to anticipate and adapt to changes. And then ultimately, of course, execution deals with the systems that we put in place, the policies, the resources that we put in place to actually do what we know is the right thing. Of course, the ability to perform these functions, or I would rather say the ability to perform these functions well, rests with the livelihoods and the collective knowledge and resources available for the communities at risk. So hence, improving and diversifying livelihoods is a key element of enhancing resilience, and it was also stressed yesterday in the session. UNITA, of course, has a track record in the achievement of these issues on increasing and diversifying livelihoods also in rural communities. Just an example from outside of the region, we worked quite extensively in Vietnam with the handicrafts communities in mountain areas, where we assisted and growers of lacquer trees to not only collect the sap, but also do some initial processing and produce additional value-added products from the same tree, like wax, soaps, and other products, candles. In the silk sector, we promoted a better varieties of silk and started to use local fruits and nuts as a natural dye for silk. In the bamboo sector, we looked at alternatives on harvesting so that you can basically avoid the need for chemical treatment. And then you can also improve the design of the products so that they're more marketable. I think in general, this kind of approach of focusing on actual resources, the talents in the region, and then identifying marketable products and services is very core to what also ECMOD wants to do. And in that sense, we would be very pleased to partner with ECMOD on advancing sustainable solutions for mountain societies. The session is supposed to address the challenges that the science and policy interface. I have the privilege or experience of working 20 years at universities. I'm working on issues of sustainability. But from currently right now, we work a lot with the United Nations University, of course, on the issues of sustainability science and education for sustainability. I think that one of the things, the key elements is that science is ultimately aimed at knowledge production. And indeed, the accountability for knowledge production needs to change. So traditionally, and my previous speaker was also referencing that knowledge production is accountable via peer reviews, and we publish in the academic community. That has started to change, that we say that policy or science is also increasingly accountable to social impacts. But ultimately, we want a situation that where science is leading to societal change, and then knowledge production needs to involve collaboration with academia and owners of the problem and their traditional knowledge. And that can then lead to accountability in social and public terms. If we want this social public accountability, then of course we need to look at facilitating structures by government. What are they doing in terms of research grant funding? What mechanisms are put in place? And what are we doing in terms of researchers' training? We need ultimately transformative competencies from scientists. I think, and without going in much details, five competencies are commonly singled out. First one is system thinking, so that we are able to understand problems in the context of bigger societal elements. The second one is perhaps the anticipation or willingness to be informed and possibly surprised by traditional knowledge and perspectives from others. without prejudice of what is the best solution. And third one, they often refer to strategic competencies in terms of interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary skills, innovation and creativity. And fourth is then probably the normative elements with regard to adoption of sustainability and resilience as key guiding concepts in the in the search for solutions. And the last but not least, the interpersonal skills in terms of ability of scientists to engage with and learn from non-scientists. Academia willing to contribute to societal change, fostering resilience and sustainability, will need to invest in developing and strengthening these new competencies. Ladies and gentlemen, resilience in the HKH region does need innovation for mountain-based solutions at a scale and pace much greater than currently happening. This is only possible with profound and informed involvement and commitment of science and policy to move the goalpost and adopt truly different and participatory methods and practices for undertaking and incorporating sustainability science and policy. It needs to be coupled with immediate action to improve and diversify livelihoods so as to increase the capacity of the communities at risk to undertake the functions that ultimately deliver more resilience. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all the panelists for keeping the time. I wanted to double check. So we have 20 more minutes until, okay, so we have 20 minutes. And I would like to use perhaps 3 minutes now to pick up on some issues among yourselves, and then I will open the floor for questions from the audience, okay? So thank you very much. A lot of very critical issues have been raised by all of you. Some of them have been addressed by several of you, but let's just start with a contradiction that I have heard in some of the things that you're saying. I understand Yamken, Wang, and Yusuf Zafar. Both of you were perhaps saying contradictory things in the sense that you are saying, Yamken, that in order to meet resilience, the solutions are in the inside. You said very clearly that we work a lot more with recovery, that understand the resistance, and that's very interesting. But you are saying that the solution perhaps comes from the inside of the system. And then, Dr. Yusuf Zafar, you were saying, however, that in your experience in Pakistan, it's extremely important to have these collaborations. And I understood, it depends how one defines the system, but I understood from your words that will be from outside the system, through the variety of different perspectives and through the engagement, for example, you give examples of civil society organizations. And if we continue with the same, we also heard from the other side of the room, some of our colleagues mentioning the need for the HKH to open up to market the products, to reach out lessons from other areas of the world. So is it the inside or is it the outside or is it both? And if you can very quickly comment on this from a very good role.
Thank you, Asun. It's a very good question. I think you just follow our comments. For me, I think in my first part, I prefer to focus on the inside reorganization after or following disturbance or following the disaster, because according to the research we have already got in the natural ecosystem, we found the stability or resistance of a system is depends on the self-organization pattern, like more biodiversity, more stability, and healthy function of a system. So I, as a independent board member in Isimod, I visited several places to surprise me in Pakistan. We visited Gilgit area. There is very sensitive, vulnerable, and fragile to the climate change. Generally, the snow and the glacier in the mountain area is accumulated a long-lasting glacier and snow cover. But due to the global warming, the glacier and the snow melting, so the village or the community just settle down just on the down slope of the mountain, so they are more sensitive to these events. So in 2014, there is hazards. But I was told, when I visited there, I was told just 10 years ago, I'm going to short my comments, 10 years ago, this village destroyed by the same events. After 10 years, they recovered very quickly. So the higher recovery ability, but they did not change the location of the village. So they did not change their resistance. That means they did not have a higher resonance. So that means inside reorganization gave them higher ability to recovery. But the outside help did not help them to have a higher resonance. So inside and outside reorganization are all important. But the earlier is recovery is inside. That's my point.
Thank you very much for the question.
Yeah, sorry for that. It's I will repeat again that what we talk is there is a inside and outside both factors are working. Pakistan faced, you know, severe earthquake two times, and then in the recent history, and then also floods from 2010 to 2015. And based on the experiences, government of Pakistan developed the disaster management authorities at various levels, the provincial and the federal level. And also, you know, as I told you, the local-based decisions also were there. And also, you know, with climate change, there is a renewed, understanding at the government level to develop those institutions which are required to develop, mitigation, adaptation, resilience, all those factors there. And as far as, this support is concerned for HKH region, we are working for a long time with DC mode. Civil societies are already working in that area. And as I told yesterday, the biggest intervention in this is the CPAC, or Belt Road Initiative. That had really changed the whole scenario in that region. We have all-weather roads, we have now so many tunnels, we have business activities. And in CPAC, unfortunately, it is more emphasis on infrastructure, on roads and energy, but there's a very little element on, unfortunately, on agriculture and also on climate change. So this is one of the reasons we raised these issues several times at all government level, that because what they are saying is that after every 10 minutes, one big trailer will be entering from Punjra Pass going to the Gwadar Port. So when 22 wheeler is going after every 10 minutes from the roads, you can see that what impact they will make in the area. So there are issues that the government is trying to work on that.
Thank you very much. We are running out of time for this 5 minutes, but I wanted to very quickly ask some sharp questions. Professor Biswas, if policymakers don't like facts and they don't understand issues unless they are reframed in their language, do they understand resilience at all? Do they understand the concept of resilience? How can we communicate and reframe resilience to policymakers?
You have to reframe the questions and the answers the way that attracts them. what is the objective of all the policymakers, literally all the policymakers, most of the countries, to be elected next time. So how do I get elected? That is the main thing. And if you cannot put it in that context, I'm sorry, we are not going to make it.
Thank you. I think that's all right. Sustainable development goals, we talk a lot about them, and they're very good. They give an ambition. But their goals, their ambitions, are they feasible? Should we be thinking about the feasibility of meeting the sustainable development goals? Can we get a little bit distracted by focusing too much on those goals rather than in the short-term necessities of the people in the region?
The goal gives a framework, and for the first time, as Dr. Sitha actually said, the decision time life is 4 to 5 years across the world pretty much. This, for the first time in human history, at least our, we have a 15-year frame in which to do certain things, which means that we are trying to cross over governments. So this gives an opportunity to the countries to take things further. And for developing world, this has been, this has come as a tremendous central power for integrating. For example, in Bangladesh, the government, the civil society, the research institute, the think tanks, all have pulled themselves together. And this has given, a lot of things are happening across for people, for communities, for ecosystems and natural resources, but this has given a way of pulling it together. So it's a framework and one has to work on it. The critical issue of this is really the capacity building of institutions. And capacity building, one of the first law of capacity building is capacity utilization. Do not start thinking of building a new institution when you have one. Use that. Build on it. And the collaboration between institution and institutions is the best way to move forward in this knowledge system. And in the ISIMOT declared areas of mountains and communities, I think one of the best approaches has already been elucidated is high-land-low-land interaction. That's where most of it. Just I'll finish with example that in Bangladesh, the total amount of rainfall that falls on Bangladesh is only 8% of the total amount of water that passes through Bangladesh. So planning has to be regional. Otherwise, how are you going to integrate that? With 92% water coming from outside, you can plan life of 160 million. So that integration planning, SDG gives a framework of doing that, but regional cooperation, regional integration is fundamental, particularly at the institutional level.
Thank you. Renia, just one second, quick question. Are markets and access to markets a precondition for resilience in the HBH?
I think yes, because we need markets to sell products and services, and that is as much as tourism or hydropower, or that's anything involved, and in that to generate economic resources and capacities to also improve livelihoods and have the capacity to plan and execute resilience plans. So yes, I think that the access to markets, but it's not necessarily markets are in Kathmandu or in India are globally. It's not necessarily saying we have to sell into the US or Japan.
No, no.
We have to connect the region, and we have to create this opportunity to connect for people to start, because in the energy area, we often talk about energy access.
Right.
But energy access on its own will not change if we don't have an entrepreneur who's then going to take and see that there is some product or service which you can take out of the mountains and sell somewhere, and therefore going to utilize this energy.
Right.
So ultimately, it's
thank you very much. We have, I'm sure, a lot of questions and a wonderful audience. So I'm going to repeat, it's extremely important you use only 30 seconds. You have one question, very concrete, and I suggest we take various questions at the same time. You can address it to one of the panelists or to the panel in general, and you can take notes about the questions. So I will take probably 3 to 4 questions at the same time. Is that okay? All right, so we have the gentleman here.
Just 1 second, it comes.
Thank you so much. My name is Murir Ahmed. I'm Policy Advocacy, Communication and Outreach Expert and Director of Pakistan Mountain Festival. One line comment and then one question. Comment, you said like for political will, I believe like we have to talk about the talk in the language of politicians. And usually that is not more than the kickbacks and the corruption practices. So I don't know how to deal with the political will. Secondly, we have very much accumulated knowledge all around institutions, but there is a lack of implementation of the knowledge on ground. We talk about large mega projects, as just Yusuf Saab mentioned and others, World Bank, ADB, IMF, but what about low-cost, community-based initiatives that brings more socio-economic change in a very less expensive way. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I had a question. Okay, sir. And there is somebody. Can the people with the microphones allocate the microphones to the hands? Yes. Yes, sir. And make sure the microphone works. We can return to you. Somebody else has a working microphone at hand? I will take this question in while you get a microphone.
Okay. Shall I? Or wait?
Yes, please, sir. Very short. It's not on. Can you please check?
Just a quick question.
Yeah. This is made for Pakistan.
Thank you.
Keeping in a view of the global priority, SDG, climate change, greenhouse effects, and DRRs, the challenge is the observations, data, and sharing informations. So these are the challenges in respect of the KHK. But I think in the policy makings, to establish integrated data acquisition systems and information exchange cooperations locally, regionally, and globally.
Thank you very much. Very important question. Lady?
Yes, my name is Aisha Khan, again from Pakistan. My question is directed to Professor Biswas. Is it possible to have climate smart politics since we have climate smart products and other kinds of development? Do you think it is at all possible to have that? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Who else had a question? Please, sir. Can I keep taking questions from the floor? Yes. Please, sir, go ahead. Yeah.
Raj from Oxfam. Professor Biswas, thank you for sharing your experience from...
Can you put the microphone a little closer?
Yeah, thank you for sharing your experience from Canada and India. So I'm wondering, as a government advisor, as a science advisor, what's your suggestion to this forum? We think that we are doing good science, but this science is not getting translated into action. So what we should be doing in terms of capacity building or institutions as part of this resilient building exercise in this region? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will take two more questions. The gentleman in the back, or yes. Please go
hello.
Ahead.
I am Mohammed Khalid Jamil from Pakistan Agriculture Research.
You need
Council.
To speak louder.
I have a question to Mr. Biswas, Professor Biswas. Yes, in South Asia we have separate development agencies and research institutes. As a result, we have very good researchers and very good development workers. But what as a researcher I think is, that we researchers are not aligning ourselves with the actual need of the time. Actually, we don't know what are the real problems on the field. And so I just want to ask that what should be the actions so we can close the communication gap between the researchers and the development workers.
Thank you very much. And we will take one last question, and I guess we don't have more time. A woman. No woman volunteers? Here.
Thank you. My name is Saskia Werners. I work at Wageningen University in the Netherlands, and I'm proud to work with EasyMod on the Hiveware project. I liked very much the notion of the resilience, not so much in bouncing back, but in bouncing forward. I was wondering, that requires some sort of vision. And what is the vision to bounce forward? Where are we bouncing to? Because otherwise, we always bounce into a situation where we have to recover again.
Thank you very much. I think we have run out of time, right, facilitator? So we have, what, 3 more minutes before we need to finish? How many?
5
minutes? Okay, so I'm going to give the floor to each of you, but in order, you want to start? We have 5 minutes for everybody to give their final comments.
Yeah, the talk, the first question was related to, you know, the mega projects and the local solutions.
Mm-hmm.
They are really using the local solutions. We developed, for example, the solar pumps with solar energy, because the 50,000 acres of land which is in the Gilgit-Baltistan is the valleys on top and the river is buried down below. So you need a simple solution that how you can provide them energy through solar and pump them and fertile the area so that the area is not dependent. If our $125 million, you know, project is based, you know, their food self-sufficiency in this area. Because in Pakistan, this area, they have a high level of malnutrition and stunting. The ratio is very high in terms of women and kids, you know. So there are local solutions, but the funding is provided by the foreign agency. That's all.
Thank you very much. Dr. Harman, you wanted to say yes, please?
I just wanted to make pick up 2 points. One is the climate smart politics, climate smart development. The other one was bouncing forward. On the climate smart politics, most cases, communities or ordinary people are doing it. They're trying their best. Very often, they're not supported by anybody. There is the people who are in the front of the coastal area of Bangladesh are raising their plinth with their own bare hands. No money, no government, no NGOs, they're themselves on the front, the sea level is rising, and they're doing it. When we costed what communities are paying to this planet, poorest of the poor across the world, is 10 times more than all the funds that are put together in the Green Climate Fund. So people are poor are contributing, it's time that rich start contributing too. So things are happening. There's a lot of smart climate movement going on. As for bouncing forward, yes, resilience is a concept of going back and understanding where we left, but the objective is not to go back. Objective is to go forward. But that has to be part of the integrated planning of natural resources, of capital formation, as well as the community themselves being able to take things forward. There are already interesting methodologies that are being practiced across the world, but that can happen at the level of work, knowledge, science, and policies.
Thank you very much. Rene, you wanted to, can you pass the phone?
Yeah, maybe on the, just on the bounce back and bounce forward. I think this is really the element of planning ahead and understanding having a joint future. So I think you bounce back because you have no alternative in mind. So bouncing forward is ultimately based on this understanding what is the challenges and planning and innovating for new solutions. Innovating for new solutions, I think it comes by not just being focused and doing more of what we already did, but finding new competences and creating the framework conditions for finding new solutions. And I think that is really the important one if you want to scale up and mainstream greater contributions to sustainability, more sustainable solutions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think I would like to give the floor first to Dr. Wang and then last.
Yeah, I like the description of the bounce back, bounce forward. It depends on the situation. Bounce back is a neutral scientific description of resonance back to the, its original or equilibrium state.
Right.
Bounce forward, then we are positive to the resilience. We are positive planning to the recovery. So I agree the description. The second one is I would like to use the example in Bangladesh. Last year we visited Bangladesh. This year, we found that after floods, the local government, they organized the local community to produce special, unique, traditional products to help the community recover from the disturbance, from the disaster. So I think the sense suitable, the feasible for community, not what we describe in the forum, in the presentation, just the fit for the local. That's what I would like to see on the ground, technology and the science and knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Rieswes. Lots of questions addressed to you.
Quite a few questions addressed to me, but let me
can
just...
Can you put the microphone in the first?
Let me just answer very quickly and in a generic way. We scientists have to learn how to interact with the politicians. Our incentive system is very skewed. The way we go up is writing papers in high impact journals. I'm sorry to tell you, our analysis indicates that average scientific journal, average scientific article is read by 10 people, including the author. You are not going to make an impact. And until the incentive system is changed, I don't think we are going to make much progress. So the EMEs, the CGIRs, the universities, I'm judged on how many papers I publish in Nature or Science or Lancet. Impact factor over 30. Nobody cares whether 5 people read it or 20 people read it. And we have to find out ways to reach the policymakers and the general public. And we are not going to get it by writing in the Lancet and or the Nature or Science. We have to have a completely different way of transferring our information so the politicians and the public, and this is very important, the public learn about what we are doing. That part, no, if I write an opinion piece in the New York Times, my university gives me 0 in terms of my KPI. If I write my paper published in Science, I get a very high KPI. So the answer is clear to me. I have to publish in Science if I want to get ahead. Forget New York Times or the Times of London or any of this, which influence the policies and the policymakers in the public. We have to change the incentive system.
Thank you very much. So we need to do lots of things. We have a large research agenda. I'm not going to use your time for the coffee break to make a summary. I think key issues in terms of the concept of resilience, the lack of investigation of resistance, the different levels of resistance, the slowness of our knowledge institutions, I think it all points towards the direction that we need boundary organizations that mediate between society, policy, and science. That's the definition of ISIMOT. I wish you a very good rest of conference. Thank you very much to all the panelists. Please, let's give them a round of applause.